of course, Adam listened to Eve. That got us in a lot of trouble from the beginning. He should have taken. See, Adam had, not only did he have the power and the authority, but Adam had the obligation. He could have taken the head off the serpent right there, folks. Now, but he had the power to do that. That was his dominion. Just like when Michael the Archangel said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you," he had God's power behind him, authority. Satan knew that. That's why he didn't go to Adam. He knew if he went to Adam, he'd probably lose his head. So he goes to Eve. What did the Apostle Paul say? He said what? That Satan attacks men always in their pride. And he attacks women always in the area of discernment. Men in the area of their pride, women in the area of discernment. There was one fellow who was smarter than the other. He didn't listen to his wife. That was Job. His wife gave him some advice. Go curse God and die. Okay. And he didn't listen to her. Now there was another fellow that wished he had listened to her. His name was Pontius Pilate. Okay. He was having some real problems to begin with crucifying an innocent man. And then his wife came to him on top of that and said, "Don't do it. Have nothing to do with this." But he feared man more than he did God. Right? Well, I bet you wish you could do that over again. Right? Well, but the fruit of the tree which in the midst of the garden, God has said, "You shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it." God never said that. Lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, "You shall not surely die. For God doth know in the day that you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." Well, let me tell you. Here. They were meant to live forever. And at this point, they were as God. They would have been what? They would have been immortal. If they had eaten of the tree of life, they would have become immortal. That's what we will be someday. Once we get our glorified body. Or after the church takes place. How do we know? We got God's word out. It doesn't get any more sure than that, right?
Yeah.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired, to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves in the presence of the Lord amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord called unto Adam and said unto him, "Where art thou?" And he heard a voice in the garden, "I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself." And he said, "Who told thee that thou was naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree?" I kind of think the Lord knew that. "Wherefore I commanded thee thou couldest not eat." The Bible said that the eyes of the Lord roam all about upon the earth continuously. And the man said, "The woman whom he gave us to be with me." Now listen to what they do. Okay. What happened? "And the man said, 'The woman that thou gave to be with me, she gave me the tree.'" And did he? What did she do? See what he's doing? He's putting
the blame on somebody.
Blame on God. "You gave me that woman. I was doing real good. I had a giraffe, and I had a monkey, and everything was okay. And you gave me that woman. She got me in this mess." Right? God never bought that, I tell you that. "And the Lord God said unto the woman, 'What is this that thou hast done?'" But she come up with an original. "The devil made me do it. The devil made me do it." Okay? And the woman said, "The serpent beguiled me, and I did eat." And the Lord God said unto the serpent, "Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above all every beast of the field. On thy belly shalt thou go, and the dust shall thou eat all the days of thy life. See, what people do is, if you watch these movies and things, and you'll see Satan coming as a slippery, slimy, hissing serpent. He wasn't. He was walking up on 2 feet, not only that, but at that time he was the most beautiful creature ever created. Satan, Lucifer, was the most beautiful creature God created. So what did you have here? You had the most beautiful creature. Well, if you come look at Ezekiel chapter 28, it describes his beauty, what he looked like. Okay, and so here now, you had the most beautiful creature confronting the second most beautiful creature. That was Eve. Eve was the pilot, the most beautiful woman that ever existed. And so now, he's telling Lucifer, you just got demoted, pal. From this point on, you're going to be crawling on your belly. Okay. And this was, of course, where serpents lost their legs. And I will put enmity between the woman in between thy seed and her seed, that shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. What do you have there? What you call evangelium. That is where the very first mention of what we're doing today, evangelizing. That means that we are the seed of the woman, and it has two applications there. Okay, it's got the seed of Eve and of Mary. Okay. And in other words, we are the children of Christ. We are related to the children of Christ. So it means that we're going to be, as long as we live, if we are truly saved, every one of us is truly saved, we are going to be at war with the world. We're going to be at war with the serpent's seed. And those people out there that are not saved, that are lost, we call them today liberals. We call them liberals today. We call them progressive socialists, you know. But we're going to be at war with them until the Lord takes us out of this world here. Until the woman, he said, well, he says, and I will put enmity between the woman and between thy seed and her seed. He shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. In other words, you can get by with a sore heel, but without your head, unless you're a politician or a liberal. Right? And so, he's saying that we're gonna take some hits. The Bible tells us very clearly, read Daniel 7, the church is gonna, we're going to lose some battles. We win the war, but we're gonna lose some battles. It's gonna get tough, just like it is in a lot of countries throughout the world today. It's coming up, it's coming here. And you better be prepared for it, because if you're not prepared for it, what do? People will lose their faith, right? Whatever you do, you never deny the Lord Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And he says, and to the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow in thy conception and sorrow, and shall bring forth children, and thy desire shall be towards thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. Well, here, obviously, you ladies that have had children know that it's not a real pleasant experience while you're going through the labor phase. Had not they sinned, we never would have had that way. Now, there are Kenneth Copeland. But Kenneth Copeland, he came up with a real theory. If any of you ever read his book, he said that in the beginning that it was meant that women would have had their children out of their side, and not the way they do it. And he said this because he said, since God took Adam or Eve out of Adam's side, and then the children were supposed to come out of Eve's side, that would have been an interesting thing. I don't know how that plans, but it doesn't say anything, and there's no hint at all. That sounds like a pretty strange theory upon somebody. Of course, he also said that God was like 6 foot 9 inches tall, and he took that off the measurement of his hand, the span of his hand. You know, these prosperity preachers come up with some very interesting sayings at times, I can tell you. And so, here now, and their desires will be towards their husband. Today, it's natural, especially amongst young girls. They need the approval of a strong male figure. They'll do anything to get the approval. They don't get the approval of a strong male figure. Often, they get angry with God. And if to them, God is the ultimate male, okay? And so, if they don't get the approval, and this is why you have, a lot of times, the people that know that better than anybody are these, what they call chicken hawks or pimps. And they will go and they find these girls and they give them that approval that they want in exchange for their service. Okay. But this is what he's telling you here. That her desire shall be to her husband, and her husband will rule over them. Okay. And so she should have been listening to him, and he shouldn't have been listening to her. And to Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree, of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shall they eat of it all the days of thy life. Now, just tell you this up. Adam had it. I mean, he had it perfect. He's in this garden. You got fruit far beyond anything that we have today. I mean, and he didn't have to till the ground. He didn't have to do anything. It was done. All he had to do was kind of hang around, keep an eye on things. And if he'd have been keeping an eye on things, he'd have thrown the serpent out, huh? But he didn't. He wasn't paying attention, was he? Okay. And so now, all of us are paying the price for that, aren't we? And I can tell you, in order to plant a garden, you got to till the ground, don't you?
Yeah.
And we run into a bunch of thorns, don't we? And so, here now, thorns also and thistles shall have bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the earth of the field. The foot of thy face shall thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground, for thou out of it was taken, from dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. And Adam called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living. And Adam also said to his wife, and Adam also and to his wife, did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothed them. Now, until that time, the animals were their pets. And, some of you can get very, very close to the pets. You can really develop them. But can you imagine making your fur coat out of your cats or your dogs? Yep. But, I mean, and so this was part of the punishment. What was it? There was a message in there. The message was what? The shedding of blood is necessary for remission of sin. Then the Lord God said, behold, the man has become as one of us to know good and evil. And now let us put forth his hand and take also the tree of life and eat that. And live. Unless he put forth his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore the Lord God set forth in the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims with a flaming sword, which turned away every way to keep the way of the tree of life. And so they were the very first people to be evicted. Now, when God had created the angels, he didn't create them as robots or as prisoners, as having no will or ability to choose whether or not to obey and serve him. That's what a tyrant or a dictator would do. If you notice with these tyrants and dictators, they have a problem with insecurity. Just like, remember old Herod? Herod killed his own sons and his own wife because he was afraid they might try to take over and take his throne away. Okay. Well, believe me, folks, God has no problem with insecurity, temptation, and his omnipotence, and with his founding presence. He doesn't have a problem with his deity at all. But he didn't want a bunch of robots, right? How many of you have children in here? Okay. Now, you want your children to be obedient and reverence you, not because they fear that you'll kill them if they don't, or not because if you have the opportunity to make them into a robot where they have no choice to command, you want them to love you from the heart, don't you? And see, that's what God wanted. He gave us a choice. He gave the angels a choice. And he gave Adam and Eve a choice. Now, why was there a tree of knowledge of good and evil? Where did that evil come from? Turn over to Isaiah chapter 14. In Isaiah chapter 14, starting in verse 12, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weep in the nation? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation on the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble and did shake kingdoms? That made the world as a wilderness and destroyed cities thereof, that opened not the house of the prisoners? All the kings of the nations, even all of them, fly in glory, every one in his own house. But thou art cast out of the grave like an abominable branch, and as a remnant of those that are slain, thrust through with a sword, and go down to the stones of the pit, as a carcass sprung under feet. Thou shalt not be joined with them in burial, because thou hast destroyed thy land and slain thy people, and the seed of evildoers shall never be renowned. Who cares slaughter for his children, for the iniquity of their fathers, that they do not rise nor possess the land, nor fill the face of the world with cities? For I will rise up against them, saith the Lord of hosts, and cut them off from Babylon. The name of the remnant, the son, and the nephew, saith the Lord. I will also make a possession for the bitter in the pools of water, for I will sweep it for the possible destruction, saith the Lord of hosts." So what's he talking about? He's talking about that by the end of the millennial kingdom, they're all going to be gone. All of Satan's children will be gone. God will have killed off all of Satan's children. And they won't be controlling any cities. They won't be controlling any that he thought. Now, again, I wonder, why did they not eat the fruit of the tree of life and live forever? Well, there's a good reason. In Greek mythology, there's a story. How many of you ever heard of Pandora's box? Well, that kind of reveals a little about human nature and curiosity. The story goes something like this. Zeus, who was supposedly God, Zeus was supposed to be God, gave Pandora. Now, Pandora was the first woman on Greek mythology ever created. Sound familiar, folks? And he gave her a box and told her, never ever, no, not ever, open this. But after a while, you know, she kept looking at that box. Like, I wonder what will happen if I open that box. So one day, her curiosity got the best of her. She opened the box. And when she opened that box, every wicked, evil, imaginable thing came out of that box. All of the evil of the world. Of the world came under that box. And she wasn't able to put it back in the box. Now, I had a friend, we called him Red, and his real name was Bill. He's gone on to be with the Lord. But he was a little Irish guy. And Hill was always up to some kind of mischief. And he used to have a milk box by his door. And on the door, you have one of those little flaps you open, you look out, and he'd climb up on that milk box, and somebody knocked on their door, and he'd get a real deep voice, and he'd get up on that milk box. Yeah, who's there? Okay. And you'd think he's, 6'4". So one day I went over and knocked on the door, and he opened it up and said, yeah, who's there? And it was me. And his face got red. But he had bought this house there in Newberry. And in the house, how many of you guys have tools that sometimes grow legs and walk away? Did you ever notice that, them tools? They just kind of, they're right here, and you go over here, and you come back, and those tools are gone. So anyhow, he bought this house, and he had one room, a small room in this house, and it was just exactly perfect with the shelves and everything for his tool store, to put all of his tools in. That's what he wanted to do. He just had to, and he wanted to make sure that his wife didn't get in there and fill it up with things. So he goes and he padlocks that room, puts two locks on that door. Okay. So his wife comes in, and she couldn't get the door open. He said, what's in there? He said, nothing. And there wasn't anything in there. There was nothing in there. And she said, oh. Well, a couple days go by. She's over there again trying to get that. She says, I want to know why you've got this locked. I want to know what's in there. He said, there's nothing in there. There's nothing in there at all. Nothing's in there. Well, a little few more days go by. And she says, I want you to open that door right now. I want to know what's in there right now. And then finally she said, if you don't open that door today, I'm calling my lawyer. We're getting a divorce. Okay? Now, does that sound like something some of you ladies might have done? I'm thinking about if I did that to my wife, she'd have to find out what's in that room. She just would have to find out what's in that room. And so, what happened is it's that old man nature in us that dictates what you can't or shouldn't have is always that the most desirable. They did a thing some time back, and it was with young girls and dresses. With young ladies, just adult teens, you might say. And they did this thing, and they had all of these different dresses, which were alike, but they were all these different colors. And all these girls were told, you can have as many as you want, every color but the one. I think it was a blue dress. Only one of you could have the blue dress. Only one. And all 10 of these girls wanted that one blue dress. They all wanted the same. And even though all the dresses were the same, they were just different colors. Okay? And that's what the way it works. And remember, where do we see that in the Bible? Remember that fellow named Ahab? He noticed this vineyard, Naboth's vineyard. And he asked Naboth, hey, how about selling me that vineyard? And when Naboth told him it wasn't for sale, what happened? That made it really, really watered. Then he just had to have it. Okay? But he didn't have, he didn't know how to deal with it. He wasn't a dark truck. He wasn't good at making deals. Okay. So who comes along? The Hillary. And she comes along, and she makes the deal, the money deal, okay? And so, that concludes the story of two trees. We got a third tree. I want you to turn over to John. In the Gospel of John, chapter 10. Jim. Big Jim. The Gospel of John, chapter 10, verses 11 through 21, we read this. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life to the sheep. But he that is a hireling, and not the shepherd, whose own sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catches them and scattereth the sheep. Now, right now they said that there's 62,000 FEMA preachers in America today. You know what that means? If you're a FEMA preacher, what have you done? You've agreed to be a hireling. You've agreed to abandon your flock when the government tells you. Okay. And I think we were one of the first people to break that. Now it's come up. But with FEMA, I couldn't believe they sent me a letter. I couldn't believe in that letter that they asked me to do that. Okay. But what they tell you in that is, this is for the security of the people, that you are to preach to your people that Romans 13 teaches you must obey the government on every level. And this includes the pastor. And exchange, if you will do that, okay? And if you will not mention to your congregation that you went, and if they ask you, if you will lie to them, if you will deny that you have gone through the indoctrination of FEMA, then in case of an emergency, if there's an earthquake or some kind of an emergency, you and your family, the pastor and his family, will be the first to have access to clean food, clean water, medical, or whatever. All you got to do is lie to your congregation. And that's all they're asking you to do. And they say there's 62,000 pastors. There's some of them that went to these meetings got cold feet, and the Lord got a hold of them. Because they're told, when you walk out that door, you don't even discuss this amongst each other. If you walk out that door, one of you says to the other, so what do you think about what we just heard? You're supposed to say, I didn't hear anything. And a couple of them couldn't take it. The conscience got to them. Remember what conscience means? With knowledge. And the knowledge was what God could do to them. And they spilled the beans. They went out and they just spilled the beans and everything that happened. And again, so many of these pastors, and guess who uses the same tactic? Rick Warren. Rick Warren, when he brings his people to Saddleback, there in California, he tells them, do not tell your congregation where you're going. Do not tell them where you're going. Don't let them know.